Jason, I am running on almost no sleep at this point.
Why is that, Jeff?
Almost no sleep. Well, because, okay, I hope you guys are ready. There's some people on this website. Sorry, I'm all over the place here. Welcome to the Rage Select Podcast. I'm Jeff.
This I'm Jason.
Jason. I hope there's some people on the website, which back, you remember when we were first talking about the Oculus Rift.
Yep.
And it was like, it was a story every week about the Oculus Rift. And there's a few people on the website that were like, oh, Jesus Christ, I'm so fucking tired of hearing about the Oculus Rift. Well, you need to tune out because I got the Crystal Cove dev kit.
It's here.
It's glorious. Oh my God, it's awesome. So we're going to talk about that for a little while. And then we're going to do news, and then we're going to answer your questions. But yes, yesterday. Okay, so let me tell you the story, Jason.
Okay, let's hear it.
Last week on like Sunday, like right before streaming Sunday, I got the email, and it was like, "Hey, your shit's in the mail." Like it wasn't. We're processing your order. It's like
that's exactly what it said too. Yeah. Yo, your shit's in the mail.
Hey, bro, your shit's in the mail. So I got a UPS tracking number. I went on the website. It was like, it's going to come to you on Wednesday. I was like, okay, that's cool. End of business day on Wednesday. So on Wednesday, I woke up, and I was sitting up here in the glorious Rage Select Studios on my golden podcasting throne, and it was such a shit day because – so where my condo is, like there's some over there, and then like behind those condos, there's like a big open wilderness area. And they had a truck that was out there doing like some kind of construction work out there. So I'm sitting here, I'm posting videos, I'm doing stuff, chewing the inside of my lips, like scratching the holes in my face.
Waiting on your man, as Lou Reed would say.
Yeah. If you had been here, you would have laughed. I was like a dog. Because I kept hearing diesel truck, like construction noises, and it sounded like a truck, like it could be a UPS
truck. Like a delivery truck.
And so I would turn real fast over to the window and look. Oh, is the UPS guy? Is the UPS guy? Motherfucker didn't come to my house until like 5:30. It was forever. And when he did come, he walked up to the door, knocked like just like
and
real
spiked it,
just like tap tap, and then walked away and left the thing. I didn't sign for it or anything. Just on my front porch. And I went out there. I was like, I didn't even have a chance to go downstairs and open the door. And I knew he was out there. And I was like, well, what if I had been away and he had left this and somebody had come by and taken my Oculus?
What if Sasquatch had come out of that wilderness and snatched your Oculus?
It's fucking Sasquatch,
fucking
man.
Bigfoot, man. Fucking always taking Sasquatch. Your FedEx deliveries.
Yep. So then yesterday, after Grant and I recorded, I spent just about a million years or as much time as humanly possible with that thing strapped to my face doing stuff with it. And hoo boy howdy. Like, I've said it before, but it bears repeating. That shit right there is the future.
Jeff's got the future sitting there right next to his PS4.
That's right. Fuck the PS4. I'll throw that shit in the toilet right now. It needs a screen. Screens are over, Jason.
Come on.
They're all the way over.
That's so 2014.
That's so 2008, man. Okay, let's get started here. First up, Jason, you got a chance today. I showed you a couple of walk around house demos. I showed you the one that's supposed to make you throw up.
Yeah.
And then you played some Half-Life. Let's get some impressions from you.
Oh, man. It's pretty glorious. It is still in development,
yes.
Clearly.
Mm-hmm.
Because, you know, everything every game that you play it's developed by a third party and retrofitted in most cases. Some of them are made specifically for the Oculus, but a lot of them are just retrofitted. To accommodate,
That's worth mentioning to people. Well, first off, let me just tell people right this. This is going to come off a little bit like a review. I know this is going to be like we're dangling a delicious bacon wrap steak in front of your face, but don't buy this. Right, this is not like you should not scramble out when we're done with this podcast and go spend $350 on an Oculus Rift.
Yeah. The consumer version is coming out in summer of 2015.
Right. Well, there's going to be several consumer versions. That's actually a beta version they're talking about. That's the first news story. But this thing... Okay, so first off, the one thing that I didn't know before I got this was that just because a thing has Oculus V1 support does not mean that it has V2 support. In fact, it specifically, those two things are not the same thing.
Right. Skyrim was V1.
Well, Skyrim still kind of works, but I'll go into that in a minute. But like, there were games like Strike Suit Zero or Beyond the Sleep, right, that had Oculus V1 support in them. Hawken had Oculus V1 support.
Yeah.
But it's not the same thing. So just because Team Fortress 2 had V1 support. It does not have V2 support. So right now, when you look at the list of games, there's a bunch of third-party things, and a lot of them are just real teeny tiny little things. There's a couple of actual games that I haven't gotten into yet. But when you look at stuff that's actually programmed for the V2, it's Elite Dangerous and Half-Life 2. Those are the two big ones. None of the other retail games, even ones that had V1 support, have yet integrated V2 support. Now, it's only been out for a month, so I'm sure that shit's going to be coming. In fact, I need to find a good website that I can obsessively look at and refresh every day. But what you can do is that once you get this thing, you can go to... There's two of them. There's one that kind of sucky that I didn't like. But you actually... There's this driver called Vorpex that you can get that costs $40. That basically has an approved list of games where it takes those games and it uses the 3D of those games to interpolate onto the Oculus.
Yeah.
Now, a lot of times that comes off as incredibly kludgy for about three different reasons. One is you have to be able to turn the field of view all the way up to like 120, this crazy deep field of view. Nobody would ever play at that unless you were like a Quake tournament person or whatever.
Right.
Second, you have to be able to mod or adjust the UI because UI on video games is all at the edge of the screen.
Right.
And for the Oculus, you need it to be in the center of the screen where you can see it.
Yeah, that was one of the things that I didn't like, and I know they're going to overcome this, and this is really one of the things that reminds you, no, this is a prototype. This
right.
is a developmental technology. And that is that you can't look with your eyes. You have to look with your head.
Right.
Because if you look with your eyes, you're going to see like the edges of the lenses, and it's also going to be blurry mm-hmm. around the sides.
Yeah.
And that was very distracting. Also, I'm a sweater. I sweat.
Yeah.
Me too. I'm Irish. if it's above like 60 degrees, I'm going to be sweating.
Yep.
And you sweat when you have that helmet on, and it your goggles get all murky and mm-hmm. foggy.
Yeah, the first few times that I was playing it, I was like, why is this blurry? I took it off, and there was actually
condensation.
There was water inside on the lens caps. So when you use this Vorpex thing, you have to tweak the shit out of everything. Skyrim does work. I loaded up Skyrim last night.
Oh, okay.
I haven't really tinkered with it very much.
Yeah.
But the problem right now is not necessarily that these games don't work. It's a thing that I never really consider. We've had plenty of podcasts from sitting around here saying, like, I would love a future where I can hold a controller and then have an Oculus and look around and do that stuff. Okay. That is not really it's not really a great experience when you try to man, like, crowbar it onto an existing game, because when you look, it doesn't have any way of disconnecting your field of view from your aiming reticle.
Right.
So when you look, you're basically just dragging your cursor around. It's like mouse mm-hmm. look, right? Mm-hmm. It's like and it makes this weird disconnect where you're trying to move with your mouse, but you're also moving with your head. So you've got two things that are controlling the same thing.
I feel like that's going to be second nature, though, if you do it enough, and if the games all adhere to that same schema.
Well, I'm going to try to do it enough. I mean, don't be mistaken. I'm going to try to do the shit out of it.
Goodbye, Jeff.
Yes. But see, I'll tell you. Okay, so Half-Life 2, and I am actually at this point, I'm so glad I never played all the way through Half-Life 2, because now I can play it through on the Oculus, and it's like a whole other thing. It's like the brand new world full of three dimensions and shit like that.
First time I played Half-Life 2,
yeah,
that opening when you're running across the rooftops.
Yes.
From the Combine
mm-hmm.
and from the Citizens Protection Corps or whatever they're called.
Yeah.
And they're shooting at you and everything, and you're running like across these planks from rooftop to rooftop and along edges and eaves and everything.
Mm-hmm.
That was amazing.
Yeah.
The first time it came out.
Yes.
Now, now if you play it, it's like, okay, yeah, this is cool. It's, de rigueur. A lot of games have done stuff like this. This is the first time I've played it since Half-Life 2 was originally released,
mm-hmm.
when it was groundbreaking.
Right.
Now I played it again with the Oculus, uh-huh. and I was like, shit, okay, oh, running on the side of the roof, they're shooting at me, fuck.
Right, and like, yeah, it's, like I was telling you before, you didn't run into any of them. Okay, so, well, I want to explain to people, and by the way, folks, I'm going to try doing a whole bunch of videos with this. I've had the thing for like less than 48 hours. I'm still trying to get everything to a point where I feel like I can put together videos for this. So those are going to come eventually. At least a few of them, because I don't know how interesting it is to actually watch somebody else, right? It's a weird kind of offshoot. But so in Half-Life, the way that they do it is you have like a bounding box around your reticle. So the reticle in the middle of the screen can actually move a little bit without turning your character, but if you push it too far to one direction, it'll actually turn your character. And then the Oculus, you can just look around and do stuff. And it's really smooth in Half-Life 2.
Like, oh, yeah.
You just turn and look and, like, boom, yeah. Shit over there. But the 3D is really the thing. Like, I feel like we've been sold on this promise of 3D technology, and the Oculus is the first thing that I've ever put on that really immerses me to the point where when you're in, like, the first time when you get out of the train in Half-Life 2 and Combine Dude, like, pushes you back, I would, like, jerked back in my chair because the depth in the game, your brain is reacting like a monkey. It's like there's shit coming at you, right? Mm-hmm. And there's a part, you didn't get to any of the shooting parts, but there's a part where in Half-Life 2, they've got those little blade motherfuckers that fly around and they'll just go in your face. And those things are legitimately terrifying when you have depth of field and you can see them. Like, you know, your brain is reacting like somebody's actually throwing a rock at you or something like that, especially when they would come up and then open up and all the blades would start spinning around. And, I see them. So that was incredible. And I can't wait to get to Trap Town. I can't wait to get the gravity gun to do some stuff in Half-Life 2. I think that I know I told people not to do it, but like that's an experience. I really, you know what I wish I could do, Jason? I kind of wish that I could just invite everybody that is a listener to Rage Select over to my house to play through 30 minutes of Half-Life 2.
Yeah, then you would get it.
Then you would understand.
You would understand how cool it actually is. And it is badass.
Yeah. Now there's two other things that I want to just briefly go over. One, because I've been thinking about this shit all day today. One is that I can't wait, because I was telling you this before, that as long as this shit takes off and it doesn't crash, right? We're going to look at this Oculus V2 thing, and it's going to look like one of those big fat 80s cell phones.
Yeah. It's going to be like having an RV strapped to your head.
Right. It's going to be like trying to have nostalgia for like a tube TV, right? You're looking at it just go, Jesus, that thing gives you cancer. So I was thinking about this. I was plotting it out. I'm thinking like, okay, so if this shit gets legit, like Samsung, Sony's got Morpheus, Oculus is working on this. They've got another partnership with Samsung. I think there's actually a full Samsung VR helmet that's coming. If we get this shit down to the point where it's like a pair of Oakleys, right? You just put it on with a strap or with a thing on it that goes out to, you know, block out the light and everything. I started extrapolating. It's weird how there's about four different technologies that once people put this shit together, just mind-blowing. And one of those pieces of technology is the Kinect. Because right now this thing has an IR camera that's tracking IR dots that are embedbed in the front of the Crystal Cove. But when you start thinking about it, you go, well, you remember, right? The Kinect can track your arm and individual fingers. And one of the most interesting things about the Oculus V2 when I was playing Half-Life was that, one, traditional input methods of playing a video game seem kludgy and old. And two, and this was a weird one for me, inverted mouse makes no sense whatsoever. Like, you're doing this all from a regular perspective and pulling the mouse down and having your thing go up, you're just like, ah, God, wrong. But I was thinking about it, and if you were able to sit in front of a space, you wouldn't even need a computer, right? Pair of headphones, pair of something the size of Oakley's, maybe like some wristbands to do tracking for your wrists, and then like a camera array. Like, imagine if John Carmack made a Kinect, right?
Yeah.
Something that had a super high-res camera that can really pick up each individual finger to the point where you can play a game with just straight-up motion. And it's weird because in the past I've said, I don't want to play motion games, right? But I actually kind of want to go buy a Razer Hydra to try out with the V2 because it really, really feels natural to do motion. Like, when you're looking at a TV, it doesn't feel natural. But when you're interacting with something that's taking up your entire field of vision, it feels 100% natural.
Yeah, there was one of the demos that you uploaded for me where you're just floating through this asteroid field.
Yeah.
And I was thinking, man, it would be really cool if I could just reach out and swat these asteroids out of the way.
Absolutely. Yeah. And then you start thinking about how the Kinect could make that totally work, right?
Yeah.
Because it can track your arms and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So you're getting rid of yet another thing, another input device, by being able to just use your hand to do this stuff. I don't know if that's, you know, if that's the thing, but that got me thinking about all kinds of craziness. And then that actually triggered a final thought, which will be the last thing we'll talk about before we get to the news. All right, Jason.
Yeah.
playing stuff on the Oculus V2 and imagining what a future where you could have a full high-res game, not Half-Life 2 that's old. Because, you know, Alex in Half-Life 2, like, she looks like pretty way closer to a person, yeah, right, than she does on screen. She mm-hmm. looks like a... She's got an expressive face. You could see her in three dimensions. She seems more real totally. That way. So if you had something that was able to eliminate any of the screen door effect like we've got, be light enough so that it just fits on your face and you don't notice it, and project a world, and then you had companies like, let's say, Frostbite 4, where you're getting people, like you remember Omar from The Wire in Battlefield 4. Realistic that guy looked, right?
Yeah. He did look a little...
He's a little Uncanny Valley-ish.
He's a little ugly.
Yeah.
He's a little like, Jesus Christ, what's wrong with you, dude?
But... If you are able to have interaction where you can use your hands to interact with other characters, Oculus or something that way with full three dimensions, and characters that look enough like people, it made me start thinking about how that makes me worried about, that almost puts me over the edge on the kids playing violent video games thing. Because the thing is that we've always had this barrier between us and our fantasy, right?
Yeah.
You start with books, right? And books, like, you know, you have to imagine that shit. So it's basically the depths of your own imagination to what it looks like.
Sure.
You watch a movie, it's like you're watching a thing that's happening. Like if you're watching Batman beat some guy up, it kind of triggers this response. It's the same as like watching somebody in real life get assaulted, right? It gives us this kind of weird synesthesia. In video games, you've got the screen that's your buffer, and the controls that's your buffer, right? But when you put this thing on, it's like you're actually there. So you imagine a demo in Oculus of like somebody who looks as realistic as maybe those characters in Battlefield 4 does in a game where you can literally reach your hands out and strangle somebody to death.
Oh, I just got a boner.
Right. Now imagine like how hard it would be for somebody who was raised with that sort of technology to start to differentiate between reality and video game, because... Yeah. That's really close.
Well, you said the magic word, really.
Which is?
Batman.
Batman?
So, hopefully, this technology will allow me to become Batman.
Okay.
Like, in real life or with the goggles on. I don't care.
You don't care?
Yeah.
I was actually thinking about how, like, if you could use Kinect plus this kind of tech, there's certain things that you could do where you could actually become better at doing things. Like, you could play a baseball game that would actually teach you how to hit a baseball in real life, right? Or you could aim a virtual gun, and that would give you like the actual real life skill to hold a gun and point it and aim it correctly. And that's what's scary about this, is that we throw around virtual reality, and it's been such a buzzword, such a term, but like this is like a reality, like a different version. And so it actually starts to get to a point where you go, depending on the sorts of things that get made for this, depending on the people that are, you know, if you start to see games that come out that are catering to a much more extreme slash, I mean, like, you know, we've talked before about, I don't necessarily make a direct correlation between like sexual violence in video games, sexual violence in the real life, but I could make a direct correlation between a game where you're abusing somebody in that style of virtual reality and then having that spill over, because that's so realistic that so many of those barriers are gone that could directly influence what you're doing. I can even see, you know, the all those scares about violence and like, oh, they learned how to shoot by playing Call of Duty. And I always kind of go, really? Because Call of Duty is sticks and holding a gun in your hand is holding a gun
it's
in
totally
your hand.
Totally different.
Right. But if you can imagine holding a prop gun in an Oculus situation and actually shooting at things and learning how to actually shoot, like if they made like an Arma, right? Something mm-hmm. that was ultra realistic where you were actually shooting or holding a prop gun that would aim, you were actually developing the real skills for that, which means that the bleed through between what you're doing in the game and what you do in reality has become so much smaller that it's kind of worrying. I mean, I don't know. What do you think? Is this a
I'm thinking
malarkey?
That, you may have something there. I think we're a ways off before we really have to start worrying about that. But if you're going to get all futurist on it, maybe this kind of thing is going to keep people from actually doing it.
Maybe so.
You know?
Absolutely.
It's like, oh, I was able to get my rocks off by killing some hookers in the game, so I don't have to go out and roam the streets tonight. Everyone is safe.
Right. So that's what I wonder, is whether it will drive people further into escape from reality through, because I was talking to you before about how if you had the right sort of Oculus tech, right, you could live in like a 6-foot by 6-foot postage stamp garbage room and then put your goggles on and be in a Tuscan villa with huge open spaces. It's going to trick your brain into not being in this little cubicle, you're going to be in this wide open space with all these vistas, and your brain will start to translate that into the way you feel. Like you did I called it the throw up demo.
Oh yeah,
where you're on this thing that's a roller coaster, it's spinning you around, and at a certain point, like I was looking at that.
There was
and
a
I
certain
was
point
like,
where I felt like I felt like gravity giving way.
Right, because your brain was translating what you saw into
exactly
in your inner ear,
and really by today's video game standards, it was pretty. The graphics were pretty primitive.
Oh yeah,
but it was enough.
Yeah,
it was enough to fool your brain.
Yeah, and so I don't know. It's an interesting thing to think about. I think that particular issue is never going to apply to you and I's generation, because we're too old. But the people who are currently in their 20s, the generation after us, if depending on how fast this technology moves, it would be it will be the generation that grows up with this as standard technology, not as a brand new thing, right? Because we have plenty of experience in the real world to the point where I'm never going to think, oh, well, because I've strangled a hooker in this video game, I can go out in the real world and strangle hookers too. But if you get somebody when they're developing who is unable to differentiate, who doesn't have enough of a solid rock hold in what real reality is, when they're in their developmental phases, I can see that causing
weirdness. You've already got kids killing other kids for the Slender Man. It's not that big of a leap before you put on an Oculus Rift and convince people that, oh, I can get away with this.
Well, right. And then, as you just said, just to reinforce that, so it doesn't sound like I'm going to go be a commentator on Fox News next week. The other side of that coin is that violence levels drop to catastrophically low levels because you can go lock yourself in your bedroom and kill and rape a whole battalion of Marines, if that's what you're into or whatever.
I love raping Marines.
And then go out and just be like, da-da-da-da-da, hello, everybody. I mean, like, you know, you could be a serial killer. You could have a pathological need to murder people and do it in the privacy of your own home to virtual people and never let that shit spill
You hear
outside.
That, developers? Get on it.
All right, well, that's enough Oculus talk. There'll be more later on, but needless to say, this thing is, seriously, they should have skipped the PlayStation 4 and Xbox One and just gone directly to this bullshit, because I can't wait to get rid of the screens. That's what I can't wait for, is for the shit to be small enough that we don't have to have big panels
anymore.
So that
there can be absolutely nothing in your condo.
Yes, that's what I would like. Two chairs and a little black box on the floor. That's right. All that it is.
And a bunch of empty bags of fast food.
Yes, a bucket with the poop bucket.
Yeah, the poop bucket.
All right, well, the first story that Jason, this is my transition story that Jason already blew up
Fucked
on me.
It up.
Is there was a report, speaking of the Oculus, that there's going to be a consumer version of the VR headset sometime mid-2015, which is another reason why you should not buy this now.
Yeah.
Now, it says that this is going to be the first because they're going to be launching this first consumer version as a limited beta to, I think, work out the last kinks before they get the real version out. The Crystal Cove V2 that I've got is 75 hertz. They're expecting the production version to be 90 hertz, which is interesting because it does mean that you have to have a pretty fast computer in order to be able to use it. But I think that for anybody who's... I mean, the thing is that... It's also projected to be between $200 and $400. I think that if it ends up being in that $400 range, it really behooves everyone out there to either like maybe go in with a bunch of friends and get one and pass it around, or wait for there to be the first price drop, right? Because remember the first HGTVs that came out, and they were like $1,500 or whatever for the size that I have sitting in here.
Right, and now they're like $700.
Now they're like $6 for HGTV. You want that first big price drop round where Samsung comes in and puts out the crappy version that everybody can have. Or I could see the Morpheus being great if Sony prods developers into having a lot of stuff. In fact, now that I think about it, Microsoft needs to get the fuck up off their asses, because the PC's got like two solutions coming and the PlayStation 4 has one solution coming. The Xbox One is already a little bit behind in sales.
You know, Microsoft's probably like, no, we tried to push things forward and you bitched at us, so no.
That's right. Well, we're gonna do it, but it's just an HD DVD player. It's just for HD DVD.
Yeah.
Hope you kept your HD DVDs. Well, talking about Microsoft, Microsoft doesn't have a VR solution, but they do own Minecraft now.
You whores.
Yep.
You blew it up.
Yep.
You blew it all up.
Last week, we reported that they were talking about it, and what was it, $2.5 billion they got Mojang for?
That is more than I make in like a year.
Yeah?
Yeah.
So there was actually a really interesting story last week. I think that a lot of people were asking, like, well, so first off, there was a report from Microsoft where they said, like, we're not going to shut down or withhold content from the PS3 or the phone iOS or any of those versions, right? And then there was a report on Gamasutra that I thought was really interesting where they said, why the fuck would Microsoft want to buy a three-year-old game that everybody already owns? But when you actually add up all the sales on all the different platforms, it's an upward trending graph, is that Minecraft is selling more and more and more and more and more.
Yeah.
It has not yet reached saturation. So,
and see, that's the thing, is that I thought that it had.
Yeah.
But it's selling more and more and more. I mean, and they seem to think that they can make the money back in, what, like, a year or something like that?
I have no idea.
I read something like that where they thought that they could recoup their investment like right away. And then Mojang came out with that. Dude, there's a creeper like right there.
Yeah.
Sorry. Jeff's looking at this picture and there's this guy standing on a bridge and there's a creeper next to him and the guy's just standing there like, yeah, it's a creeper. So
yeah,
what?
I said this last week. Minecraft is Jason's Dark Souls. He gets he's way more into Minecraft than I am.
But yeah, there was a letter from Mojang where he was where he said, you know, I didn't do it for the money. I did it for my sanity.
Yeah.
And it was a very impassioned, honest letter where he's like, I'm sick of this shit. I don't want to do it anymore.
Yeah.
I'm some sort of figurehead now. I never wanted to do that. I just wanted to make cool games.
Yeah.
And now he's this icon. And he's like, no, no. And he's like, it's not about the money. It's about my sanity. And I was like, but it's also kind of about the money.
Well,
I mean, it
helps that you have enough money to be able to quit making money in order to go be sane somewhere. Right.
Exactly.
But he also said that he's going to go off and he's going to just tinker and do whatever he wants to. And that if one of those things becomes a thing, then maybe. Actually, what he said is if one of those tinkering things becomes another big thing, he will immediately sell it off to somebody else and go fuck off because he doesn't want to be in the.
Yeah.
And I can understand that.
Yeah.
Sort of. I'm still fame whore. But,
well, you know, it's like, I don't want to be this guy. I don't want to be this guy. Well, okay, I'll go on Conan.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, all right.
But I don't know. I look at Minecraft as one of those things that's so popular that, I mean, it's like Call of Duty, right? They can keep putting out like map and texture packs for Minecraft and keep making money with $10 add-ons, right, to Minecraft.
Sure. But they're going to need to push it a little bit further, I think. I mean, I just played on the console. I know it's very different on the PC, but, you know, you release these texture packs and everything, but they really, I don't know, some of them are drastic, like the candy texture pack, but it doesn't really affect gameplay that much. And I hope that we start seeing some more drastic improvements or options coming to Minecraft to keep it alive.
You know, it's just going to be a fucking microtransaction store where you can buy diamond for $2, right? Speculation, but if I was Microsoft, that's what I'd do. Mm-hmm. I'd be like, your kid, you know, when your kid comes running in and he's crying, he's like, what happens? Jimmy locked onto my game. He took my dime. He threw it in the lava. He'd be like, oh, okay, fine. Here's 10 diamond. Just get the fuck away from me. Go put your sticky fingers on the controllers, all
right?
Some
friends of mine are having a Minecraft-themed birthday party for their kid.
Uh-huh.
And
you want to go over with the Angry Birds and just throw Angry Birds at his Minecraft cake?
No, I want to show up dressed up like a creeper.
Yeah.
And just randomly explode among groups of children.
You know people don't actually. You can't actually just. You can only do that once. It's a one-time thing,
one
Jason.
Time. It's like, have you seen the news, Jeff?
Yeah.
People are blowing up all the goddamn time.
Things blowing up. I just like to imagine you walking around a party with just the creeper head with a really rough hole in it that you could put a beer bottle into.
Yeah.
Just walking up to kids going,
they all run screaming.
Except for that one, the dorky kid with the glasses from the 90s movie who just looks at you and won't run or go anywhere.
And then I go, boom, and punch him right in the face.
Well, yeah. All right, next up, this is just a FYI, folks. Grand Theft Auto 5 is coming to the PS4 and Xbox One. They've got a release date November 18th and coming to the PC in 2015, which kind of chaps my hide because
still no Red Dead Redemption.
Well, no, I want all three versions to come at the same time so I can get the PC version.
Because
I already bought Grand. Well, actually, no, I didn't buy Grand Theft Auto 5. They sent me a copy of Grand Theft Auto 5.
Yeah,
but when Grand Theft Auto 5 comes out on the PS4, we're gonna have to get that and do something on the show. And then when it comes out on the PC, we're gonna have to buy it third time and do something on the
show. Maybe we should wait on the PC until some good mods come out and then play it.
Maybe so. We're getting close to 3 million on the YouTube channel. We're pretty close.
What?
Might even be over it by now, but I don't know. So that's just, that's an FYI thing. There was a new trailer. Did you watch the trailer that came out last week?
No, I did not.
Picket Fence and a Dog Named Skip. It's kind of a standard trailer. I still think that the first GTA 5 trailer is the best GTA 5 trailer. The one with Skeletons by Stevie Wonder in it. That's just that montage where I want it now.
Yeah.
All right. Next up, we've got some sales news. First up, we had a story last week that Destiny had shipped 500 million to retail, but now after a week, Activision is reporting that sales of Destiny are 325 million worldwide.
Not quite their budget yet, is it?
Not
from what we've heard.
That's the problem, is we don't really know.
Yeah.
Like, they said there was that story about that budget, and then, like, the Bungie people came out, and they were like, oh, we don't know what the fuck they're talking about. That's fucking crazy.
That's marketing money, son.
I just wanted to announce Destiny 2, right? Where they fix everything, and it's better storyline.
Already?
Yeah, why not?
Come on.
I guess it's been...
You're about to enter into a time of bounty. Those 2 or 3 months where there are more games than you can handle.
Right.
Why ask for Destiny 2 already?
I don't want Destiny 2 now. I just want to know there is a Destiny 2 coming.
Oh, well, of course there's a Destiny 2 coming.
I don't know. Somebody I was talking with online said that they read an article that said that Bungie thought that Destiny, they wanted to have a 10-year lifespan. I'm just like,
what?
You are a crazy person. That is a crazy thing. In 10 years, we're going to be flying in rocket packs with the Oculus Rift and the cars that drive themselves.
Yeah.
Like, what the fuck am I going to need Destiny for at that point? I'm going to be able to murder a hooker in my room all by myself.
Destiny's going to be fucking quaint, man.
Right. You look at Destiny and be like, oh, right, like Bubble Bobble.
Yeah. Or hieroglyphs.
That's right.
Or Stonehenge.
Well, speaking of things that sold really, really well... The 3DS version of Smash Brothers is out in Japan, and
I still don't understand it.
It sold 1 million in its first week, so past 1 million sales. I know that there have been some beta codes for people who are like platinum Nintendo members to get the demo for it here in the U.S. Considering that I can't make 3DS things any work on, I can't capture off of a 3DS. There's not really any good reason for me to do it, just because there's a lot of other stuff. I have fucking Oculus Rift. I got 3D in my whole brains. But I can't wait, because by the end of the year, it's going to be interesting to see how many people have Smash Brothers as their game of the year.
I played a lot of Smash Brothers when I was off in space.
Yeah.
Still don't get it.
Wait, did you?
Yeah.
On what? The Wii version?
Various Wii versions.
Well, not the Wii U version.
I don't fucking know, man.
Oh, okay.
I was handed some controller.
It was a Wii controller you were handed.
And I pushed buttons until I died.
Was there Smash Brothers on the Wii?
I don't know, man.
Was it a GameCube controller?
I don't know.
Okay, all right.
I don't know. I was drinking, and there was Smash Brothers, and I was pissed.
Okay.
Because Smash Brothers.
Okay.
And everybody was whipping my ass all the time.
Right.
But
it's just like a normal fighting game.
Pretty much.
Okay. Mortal Kombat, that's your jam?
Soul
Calibur?
But I'm sure I'm not very good at that anymore, because it's been years since I've sank any amount of time into it.
Yeah, at some point, I don't even know if I'm trying to run down the roster of people that we usually have on the show. I'm trying to run down the roster of people that we know, and I'm having a hard time figuring out if anybody is a big Smash Brothers fan.
Aaron.
No.
Is he not?
No, he's not. I talked to him about it one day.
He's a big Smash Brothers fan.
Ooh, talked about it. He's like, I don't understand it. I don't want to know. But we're going to cover it, and then people are going to be upset about how bad we are at it.
I think it's a twitching pile of shit, but I get it. I mean, other people like it. Okay, fine. I'm in the minority.
Well, as near as I can tell, it's a microcosm of Nintendo fandom, right? Is that there is a small group of people who are just completely in love with all things Smash Brothers. Like, they may not be as big as fans of Modern Warfare, right? There might not be as many of them as fans of Modern Warfare, but if you watched, there was the E3, Microsoft, or, you know, Nintendo didn't have a press conference, right? But they did rent out one of the halls and have a Smash Brothers tournament.
Yeah.
And it was like, you'd see like 700, 800 people in there just fucking screaming like a Beatles concert.
It's bananas,
and
just
up on their feet. So, I'm not going to tell you people shit's out of whack.
Nerds.
I did find it interesting, though, that there was some report that people are breaking the circle pad.
Dude, that would totally be me.
Yeah, just cracking the circle pad right off the side of the thing.
Oh, yeah. Well, you remember the Max?
Which one?
The old controller for the 8-bit Nintendo, the NES Max.
Oh, sure, yeah.
Where it had that,
the RC Pro-Am controller.
Yeah, yeah, the RC Pro-Am controller.
That's what it was for, is RC Pro-Am.
Yeah. I fucked that thing all up.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. I wrecked so many Super Nintendo controllers playing Mario Kart.
Yeah.
I mean, you could see if you took apart the Super Nintendo controller, you could see the pressure marks in the plastic where I was pushing so hard.
You're pressing the buttons so hard?
Yeah.
Jesus.
It was destroying the controller.
I've never broken a controller in my life. I've only thrown a controller like half dozen times in my life.
Yeah. You're doing it wrong.
Yeah, I guess I am. All right. Well, I tell you what, we got some TGS news now to get into before we're done. We got about, we're making great time this week. And the first one is there was a trailer for Silent Hills.
Yeah.
Concept trailer for Silent Hills. Okay, so I would like to take this opportunity. I'm not going to say that, like, oh, I was wrong about everything I said about PT, but, like, that trailer was sick, bro. Like,
yeah,
that was super cool.
On IGN, hey, here's journalism these days. TGS 2014, the new Silent Hills concept trailer is sick.
Oh, I didn't even realize it said that. I didn't realize that it said that on the
I thought that's why you said it.
No. Yeah.
Hey, that's great journalism, Lucy O'Brien.
Oh, shit.
Dumbass.
Are you going to start beefs with IGN now?
Fine, bring it.
We're just gonna
I will fight all of them at the same fucking time.
Yeah?
Yeah. Oh, God!
Nerds.
Gamergate. This is why people say game journalism is absurd.
Uh-huh.
Because your headline says, this new concept trailer is sick.
Right.
Fuck you. God damn it.
Anyway, this concept trailer...
That said, it is pretty fucking sick.
It's pretty sick, man. Like, I liked the way, stop the recording, go watch the TGS 2014 trailer.
We'll wait.
We're going to talk about it. Just hit the pause button.
Yep.
And are you done? All right, good.
Did you watch it?
Okay, good.
You okay?
Because we're going to talk all about it. We're going to talk all about it.
Did a little bit of pee come out?
Yep. So this is, okay, remember we were talking all about PT and scary games and stuff like that, right? And I said, like, I don't really get very scared by games.
But
what I do like is that so much of the time the genre of horror has some of the most creative things because you can't scare somebody with the same thing over and over again, so I feel like they have to continue. Like, look at action movies, right? And just how big is that explosion, right? There's some innovation or whatever.
Right.
But when you go to horror, I feel like as time goes on, like it used to be, what's that with the house on Haunted Hill where they just have the anatomy skeleton hanging off of a fishing wire and everybody's like, ah!
Why do you say that? I watched that movie yesterday.
Yeah?
The original with Vincent Price?
Uh-huh.
It's good. It's actually got some, there's one in particular scare in that is still just like,
Right. But this was, okay, so... I don't know why Norman Reedus, why Durrell, or whatever his name is.
Daryl.
Nick told me you have to say Durrell. It's Lurl and Durrell or whatever. I don't know.
Okay.
I think that he's just hearing that because he's posh Nancy boy or whatever. But
Durrell.
when we reviewed The Walking Dead Survival Instinct. So whoever this person is walking down a hall in a, like, kindergarten or whatever.
Yeah.
In Silent Hill.
Yeah, it's a bad idea. Don't do that.
Go to Silent Hill Taco Bell.
Yeah.
There's only so many horrifying things that are already happening there that could happen.
Exactly. Mostly diarrhea.
Yeah, but this was, I thought that this first part was absolutely incredible where there's a ball and it's bouncing up against this door and then it bounces and the door opens and then it goes in and the character looks in and then it's a head and this little kid picks up the head and then fucking centipedes start coming out of the head. And I was
Yeah.
And I start running down the hall. There's centipedes in the hall. There's a bunch of robot parade And then there's like this giant
hand
lady monster worm.
Oh, that was where it got really freaky.
And then that whole, like, this door flies off the wall, and then it opens sideways, and the character is, like, looking at the giant lady. I wish he'd stop for a second and look more at the giant lady monster, because I wanted to see that shit.
Yeah. It was freaky.
It was awesome. It was awesome. And I hope that part of that, I don't know. Let's talk a little bit. Do you think they're going to do the siren thing? Do you think they're going to do the Silent Hill siren transition?
I don't know.
Because that almost seemed to me like that was, like, an extended transition into Silent Hill instead of just like walls flake and now you're in Silent Hill.
Right. Yeah, that was, I mean, maybe it's time to retire the siren because the siren was very much a cue. It was like a musical cue in a movie. It's like, okay, get ready. Something's about to happen.
Or maybe, you know what I'd like to see is if the game spent, like, had more subtle ways of like letting you open a door, like making the door transition where you open a door and then it goes through the door, right? And then without letting you control it, right? But then sometimes when you open a door, then you're just walking into Silent Hill. And, like, have more subtle transitions throughout the course of the game. And then it's, like, the right before the very end of the game, like, you're standing in the middle of the street, you just hear the siren go off, and the entire place just fucking...
Yeah.
You're just like, ah, shit! But, yeah, I don't want people to think that just because I had my little tizzies about PT that I'm not really interested in playing this because
I'm very interested.
Really interested in playing this. Kind of feel like I should even maybe go back and play some of the other Silent Hills because I only played two. I never played one or three.
Yeah.
I played the prison one that they fucked all up. And then I've heard that Homecoming is straight garbage. It's just
Our Downpour on the Wii was good.
Was that
was it Downpour?
Or was that Silent
I can't
or,
keep
was
them.
That Shattered memories.
God, I can't remember.
I really did want to play that one
straight,
but it's so hard to go back to Wii games. They're so ugly.
Yeah,
I really wish they would take that. I really wish that I could play that on goddamn Oculus Rift. I know that's going to be the theme for this particular episode, but yeah. So that was cool. Now, Jason, we're about to transition over into things Jason doesn't care about.
No good.
All right, part one of things Jason doesn't care about. Final Fantasy 15. We now have a demo in 2015 that's going to come with the release of Final Fantasy Type Zero HD, which, cover your ears if you're not into JRPGs. This was Final Fantasy, what the fuck was this called? It's Final Fantasy 13 Agito from the Fabula Crystal Novalis. Because you remember when Final Fantasy 13 was originally going to be released, there was going to be three games: Final Fantasy 13, Final Fantasy Versus 13, and Final Fantasy 13 Agito, this PSP game.
I'm going to need a flowchart, man.
Yeah. This got turned into its own game on the PSP that only came out in Japan, and now they're releasing it in the US on the PS4 and the Xbox One. I always wanted to play this game, so I'm interested in playing it. I mean, you know, it looks like Final Fantasy is shit.
Yeah, it does.
It's completely Final Fantasy.
Unapologetically so.
Mm-hmm. But then it's also going to come with the demo for Final Fantasy 15, which, in further news, there's two things which I feel like this game used to be Final Fantasy Versus 13, and now it's 15. So the first one...
Oh, God, I don't understand.
The first thing is that Tetsuya Nomura, the director, is actually stepping away to do other projects, and the person who created Before Crisis and Final Fantasy Type-0 is taking over as director for the series. This thing has been in development for freaking ever, and there is a new trailer out that's pretty saucy, and it shows these dudes, and they're driving around the wilderness in this car. I'm going to see if I can find some of the action, right? This is supposed to be a little bit more action-oriented, and I like the way that, I mean, even though they're all just, like, really solid anime hair, that at least from what we're seeing in this particular trailer, it seems like this hues a little bit more to future gothic instead of future anime.
Yeah.
It's just darker, and it doesn't have all of, like, I feel like Final Fantasy 13 was just dipped and coated in neon before it came out.
Sure.
Everything was neon and flying, and the guys are, like, driving around in a BMW or something in the wilderness, but then they're going and fighting shit.
It's an interesting aesthetic they've got.
Yeah, and I like the idea of having, because this was designed by the, that guy was the designer for Kingdom Hearts, right?
So right.
It was always supposed to be more of an action-style game than a, you know, here's what your party does. And it looks really nice. It's got some really smooth animation. Go check the trailer out.
Looks interesting.
Final Fantasy's kind of been on a losing streak with me with the whole 13 thing, and they dragged that out over three games, right?
Yeah.
So it's been years since I wasn't even doing this job when 13 first came out. I was just, you know, doing shit, regular shit. So I'm really looking forward to kind of getting a fresh start, even though this originally started out as a 13-style title. But it looks pretty cool. Also, speaking of 13 over and over and over again... there was a report that they're bringing all the trilogy of 13 to Steam. They added Steam on the page, so they're putting out Final Fantasy 13, 13.2, and 13.3, or Lightning Returns 13.3, in a pack on Steam that you can get. I assume that they'll add a few different things to it. I don't really know if anybody cares enough about 13. I'm actually interested to know if anybody here at Rage Select gives a shit about 13.
Yeah,
I kind of do a little bit.
There are probably a couple of people,
not all that much. All right, next. You got to see a little bit of this.
Oh, yeah.
20 minutes. There was a full 20-minute demo at TGS of The Phantom Pain. I'm sure people want me to talk about this because this demo did exactly what I've been wanting them to do, which is...
Show more than that one desert.
Right. Show more than just that one desert. So this particular trailer takes place in a jungle area, which... Like I really like because it reminds me of Snake Eater.
Right. Yeah. Right? That's well. See, when you did it, I thought I walked in and you were watching this trailer, and I thought, oh, okay, so we're gonna play Snake Eater first. All
right. Right. But it's not. Yeah.
But then I realized, wait, it's a little too pretty.
Yeah. So there isn't a high res version out. I think that there might be by the time this comes out. But at the time of the recording, the one I'm looking at is 720. It's a little blurry, but it's got a lot of really cool stuff in it. Like, they bring out the horse in the very beginning, and then they put him away. There's a part where Snake is climbing, which shows you a lot more. It's an interesting way to get around the environment. They show the sniper, Quiet.
Yep.
And they actually show how you can, in the game, you can set her to different areas and then have her support you by taking people out.
That's pretty cool. They pull off some sweet moves.
They also have this really cool balloon animal snake that he throws out. Like, it looks like a landmine, and then like this balloon of him pops out of it.
Yeah, there's still that trademark silliness.
Well, I like to imagine that because in the Peace Walker right, you have to research different versions of the technology that you use. I like to imagine the first version of that technology is that Snake stand behind a rock and he blows up the balloon and this it's like making it
like a balloon animal version of Solid Snake.
Yeah, then he has to make it. He has to stand there and put it all together.
His name is Balloon Snake.
Yep. Now, unfortunately, I can't actually make out any. I mean, you know, this is all in Japanese at TGS, and there isn't any commentary. Or I can't tell. There's tons of commentary. I don't understand any of it.
Yeah, those Japanese, they're talking their fucking asses off.
Yep.
Don't know what they're saying.
But there's a lot of cool stuff that you can see in here. I mean, it looks like you can... there's one part where he identifies a bunch of... looks like animals in the environment, and I don't know if there's going to be any kind of like stamina recovery mechanic, because he also does that, he got that weird cigar thing where time goes really, really quickly.
Oh, yeah.
But you don't have to eat or anything during that time, which is a little weird, considering that eating and psych meter have been parts of the Metal Gear franchise. But you came in just in time to see at the end, there was actually a really gripping kind of scenario where you're running away from this particular area.
Yeah, that was pretty exciting.
And guys are following you, and you're trying to use Quiet, and you're blowing up bridges and helicopters and all kinds of shit.
It felt very dramatic.
Yeah, I feel like when you were watching that like Jason asked me, does this game come out next year? And I was like, Jason Murphy, you're not interested in playing a Metal Gear
I'm really not. even with that, I'm not. I mean, it looks like another Metal Gear game. But.
Yeah.
But yeah, that was exciting.
Yep, I really like the new environment. I wonder. Destiny now has me wondering how many of these environments there are. Right, we've seen the Afghanistan one. We've seen this jungle one. Like, I'm hoping that there's like another 10 environment, one of these huge areas to keep going back to, and that it's not just some horse shit. All right. Well, we've got one more news story, Jason, and it's a really, really fun one. Apparently, somebody, a Counter-Strike modder, has gone in and created the house from Gone Home in meticulous detail as a Counter-Strike map.
Sweet.
I think that I might have to go find this map and then play a game of Counter-Strike and overlay some of the audio diaries over the Counter-Strike gameplay footage.
Oh, that's perfect.
Also, you know what? We got a little. I metered these out. We've got just a few more minutes. I don't want to end on a downer, but so we're just going to take a break. We'll be back with plenty of uppers after this. So, you know, the guy who created Load Runner passed away.
Yep.
Which I've actually been thinking might be a good excuse to go play Load Runner because, dude, I don't know about you, but when I was, that was one of the first video games I ever played, and holy shit, Load Runner.
I played the Nintendo one a lot.
Yeah?
Not the one that was on, you know, PC and Apple first, but I played the Nintendo one. From Broderbund.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I played that a lot. Even though I didn't really like it all that much.
Yep.
I played it a lot.
Yep. Me too. Wasn't ever really a super big fan of Load Runner, but hey. Also, the first game that I can remember in the history of my gameplay career that had a level editor. You could make your levels for.
Yeah, yeah.
So, yep. Load Runner. I'm sure there's a free version in a browser that you guys can play out there. If you've never played Load Runner before, play it for 5 minutes and then go, oh, this is garbage. And it's like, I'm not going to judge
it. It's worth checking out. It is a part of gaming history.
Yep. All right. Well, we're going to take a quick break. When we come back, we've got a lot of really great, fantabulous questions for this week, Jason. Mail@rageselect.com is the email address, and we'll be back in a moment. All right, and we're back. And folks, I'm pre-gaming for Jeff versus Beer, so if I get a little loopy by the time this is done, I can't be held responsible for what I do when I'm drinking Lone Star, Jason.
Yeah, and I'm already like 4 ahead of you.
Well, but you're a professional. I'm just like a hobbyist drinker. You
need to up your game.
I don't know, man. I guess I need to find a better hangover cure, because that's the thing, is that I still am able to indulge it. I'm just going to sleep until 4 and not do anything. Fuck videos. Make videos today. All right, folks. Well, mail@rageselect.com is the email just sending your emails to. And our first one comes in from Andrew. And Andrew says, hello, Jeff and Jason. Andrew Bond on the site with a question. With the recent release of Destiny, it seems like there's been a trend this year in games. Games that are hyped up to the point where they create expectations they can never meet. Watch Dogs, Titanfall, and Destiny were all hyped up as the next big games, and yet have mostly received mediocre reviews. While I still enjoyed Watch Dogs, I can understand people's disappointment with it. I didn't play Titanfall, and Destiny is starting to get pretty repetitive to me. I was wondering if you thought that this was due to all the insane marketing that went into these games, and if so, do you think a great marketing campaign should affect the score of a game? Thanks for the hours of entertainment, Andrew. Now, we talked a little bit about this on the Destiny review.
We touched on it, yeah.
But I feel like there's I wanted to get into a little bit more here.
Sure.
So it's sort of paraphrase. I mean, it's really just a question of like what responsibility and quality does an artist have? I almost feel like there's a disconnect there, right? Like the programmers of Destiny maybe wouldn't go out there and be like, this is the greatest fucking greatest game, right? But then you've got a marketing department that has the skills to go out and manufacture just a crazy amount of buzz and desire in people. And that's their job.
Yes.
But the thing is that, I mean, have we ever seen a marketing campaign that was like, hey, play Destiny.
It's pretty good.
It's pretty good. It's not really terrible. Hey, everybody. I mean, you know. Watch Dogs is a perfect example where they showed us these tiny little slivers of Watch Dogs that made it seem like a really, really innovative and good game.
Yes.
And then when it came out, not as much.
Yeah. I really don't think that the marketing should affect the ratings critically of a video game.
Okay.
Now, you know, the people that rate games like us, we're people.
Are we?
Ostensibly.
Okay.
People are going to be influenced by everything, all of the other external stimuli that come in, whether it's like, you know, I played this game by myself and it was boring versus I played this game over at a party and everybody was having a great time and goddamn Super Smash Brothers is the most amazing thing ever.
Right.
You know, all of those things,
or like
including the marketing.
Or like standing alone in your house playing Fruit Ninja.
Right.
All alone on a Friday night by yourself. It's like, oh my God, this is the most depressing game I've ever played in my life.
Exactly. Yeah. So all of that, including marketing campaigns and everything, will influence your enjoyment of a game. If you are critically assessing a game, the best you can do is try to shut all of that out and just think empirically about the game itself. But that's always that's
it's
difficult.
Kind of boring, though, right? Then you're just like it's like one of those review breakdowns with like graphics 6.247, you know, sound 7.8. By the way,
you're trying to apply some sort of empirical method to an artistic endeavor, and that is specious from the beginning,
right? I almost feel like the other part of it is just that it's a larger cultural thing, right? That we live in a culture where we're bombarded every day with so many things that are trying to get our attention, that there's not room anymore for. It used to be with video games, right? You have a game, maybe have a launch trailer, maybe one like announcement trailer or something, and then a spate of screenshots in between, right? But there's so many. I ignore most of them now. Here's the second trailer, here's the third trailer, here's the dev diary 1 through 8, and I feel like by the time you get to the game that you know so much about it having that information has kind of artificially inflated your idea of what the game is going to be. I don't know. It's hard, and I feel like a lot of this stuff could be better served by easing back on that stuff.
Right.
You know, to the point where there's been some games where they'll buy up every single ad on YouTube for a while.
Right.
To where I get sick of it. I get the
absolutely
opposite, where I'm just like, well, fuck you, GTA. Yeah. I don't even want to play. Well, I don't play, but, you know, like, I'm tired of seeing. I remember when The Lost and the Damned was coming out, and it's just like, every video on the internet had the Lost and Damned trailer to the point where I was just like, God,
well,
fuck that.
All of that external stuff, I think, it depends on who you are and what your sensitivity is to it. But all of that external stuff will affect you to a certain amount, but it won't. All things considered, it might shift your perception of the game a little bit in one direction or the other.
Yeah.
But the game is still the game, and you're going to know that. You know, people are savvy enough not to be completely swayed by that. Like, Watch Dogs had all of this amazing stuff, and then when we played it, you know, it was okay.
Mm-hmm.
I think my perception and my review of it were probably swayed negatively because I expected it to be so good.
Yes.
But it didn't do it so much to where it made it a bad game, to where I perceived it as a bad game.
Right.
You know, it wasn't that different from how I would have experienced Watch Dogs had it been in a vacuum.
See, I don't know. I almost feel that there is, like, if you come from a neutral stance, right? There's a game coming out this week. You've never heard about it. We're going to play it. We're playing it on the dojo. We're going to play it. It's bad. Okay, whatever. We get a bad game from time to time.
Sure.
I mean, you know, most games are at least of a certain level of competency. I feel like that particular scenario hurts way less than when you expect something to be really good and then it lets you down.
Yeah.
That because you get like you go to midnight launch, I'm so excited, and you get it home, you're like, oh my God, this is gonna be the best ever. You put it in your Like, it's not bad. It's just not what it
said.
Like,
well, it's like Minecraft.
Right.
I knew, you know, when you and I first played it, we knew very little about it. We knew it was starting to be a big deal. Or maybe it was already a big deal, I guess. Not as big as it is now. But we didn't really know that much about it. We knew it was a very, you know, sandbox game. And then after we played it for 30 minutes, we were like, oh.
Yeah.
Oh, shit.
Actually, Minecraft was great because it was the exact reverse of that scenario.
Right.
I had a poor opinion of Minecraft. And then when it finally clicked, I was like, oh, okay. Yeah. So I feel like, okay, so that's what people need to do is they need to market their games as like, this game is garbage. Evil Within is terrible. Nobody should play it. We're going to print 10 copies of it. Nobody can even play it. We don't even want it. And then you play it, and you're like, oh, this is, what are you talking about? This is way better than you thought it was. Like when a friend tells you that a movie is just complete and total garbage, and you go watch it, you're just like, dude, this is fine.
Yeah.
Because your expectations were so diminished that even by being a mediocre movie, it seems better than it was because you went in expecting just dog shit out of it.
Yeah. Like your expectations, again, they can make all the difference.
Like, I feel like that's what happened with me and Aliens Colonial Marines. There's so many people who were so hyped for it that when they played it and it was bad, they were like, eh, but I was meh to, I don't even know if I really want to play this. So when I went to play it, I just laughed at all the horrible shit that was happening in the game.
Yeah.
It was like, I didn't have an expectation that was up here, so it wasn't as offensive to me when I went to go play it
right
at the end of the day. We have another question that's kind of like this later on, but it comes out from a little different direction. But thank you, Andrew. Our next one comes in from Mike S. Mike S. says, greetings, Jeff and Jason. I've recently started brewing my own beer and want to make one to celebrate Rage Select. What style of beer do you think would best epitomize the site? IPA, stout, red ale, etc. Also, what do you think would make for a good name? Dojo Juice, The Wrath of Dongocles? Thanks for all the entertainment, and keep doing what you do, Mike S.
One, Mike S. is my new best friend.
Okay.
Two, I don't know. What style of beer would it be?
I don't think it'd be an IPA, because I don't like IPAs.
Okay. You don't like IPAs. I didn't know that.
I'm not a big fan of hops.
Okay.
I think it kind of tastes like soap, personally.
My favorite is Hefeweizen.
Hefeweizen? Okay.
But I don't think that epitomizes the site.
Yeah. I mean, it's a half wheat. I think that Rage Select goes big or goes home.
Like a
pale
ale?
Wheat or something. Pale ale might work. I think maybe like
a lager?
A lager. I'm a big fan of lagers.
Lager.
But a lager, maybe a Bock. It could be a stout with, like, sriracha in it. Breathing fire on the dojo.
Let's go with lager.
Lager? Okay.
Yeah. And what would make a good name? We want to hear from everybody else on this, too.
Yeah, I think
Help name the Rage Select beer.
Yes. Beer, Cleese.
Dojo Juice.
No.
Wrath of Dongocles are some of the ones that Mike threw out.
Right. What else? What do we got? It's a lager.
Marston malt. Marzipan malt.
Jeff Kent IPA. That would be a good one.
Gary's Grog.
Gary's Grog. Lager Steve, maybe.
Oh, man.
Just Ding Dong.
Mm-hmm. Ding Dong Lager.
Ding Dong Lager. Yeah, that could be good. If you make
Loco
that,
Lager.
Loco Lager. Yes, I think that'll totally work. Yeah, but pick your own. Pick your own. You've got plenty to choose from. What he needs to do is he needs to make one beer for each character that we've had on Sequential Saturday. So you get the Marzipan Malt, you've got the Loco Lager, you've got the Robot Stouten, or I don't know what it would be.
Satan Stout.
Satan Stout, yeah. I don't know the rest. Darth Situation and Nathan Snake. All right. Let's see. Next one here comes in from Metal Gear Ray. And Metal Gear Ray says, greetings, Jeff and Jason, or possible other host. Thank you for all the content that Rage Select Santa brings on a daily basis. It gives me much merriment, and I bask in the glow of each video and podcast like a gleeful child. Have you ever seen a child bask in anything? That's, no.
I almost answered that really inappropriately.
Yep.
Go on.
All right, so this one, I picked this one out specifically for you, Jason, even though it was directed at me. On to the question. Jeff, you, sir. I keep hearing you denounce movie theaters in various podcasts, and I have to ask you why. If it has to do with the audience, I know of the Alamo, where most of those problems are remedied. So is it concessions or menu prices? Tell me! I am working on opening a theater right now, and I'm just curious. I pray to the Beard Man, the Murfshwood Bros, and the Grant. What is this, Destiny? That this message finds you in good health. Metal Gear Ray. Jason.
Metal Ray Gear.
Metal Ray Gear. Sorry. Sorry, Metal Ray Gear. I just used to saying it the way that it is in the game.
Yeah.
Jason, would you like to tell the story? You like to rant for 10 minutes?
So I took Allison. I took Allison to see Guardians of the Galaxy. She hadn't seen it yet. And we went to an Alamo Draft House. Now, I've been going to the Alamo Draft House since it opened, since there was one in downtown Austin.
Yeah.
And it was just this divey punk rock theater that kind of smelled like feet, and it was fucking awesome.
Where was the first one?
On 4th and Colorado.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Yep, yeah. I remember that. Right across the street from the 80s bar, right?
Yeah. The 80s gay bar.
Was that a gay bar?
Oh, no. Then it wasn't a gay bar.
Yeah.
It is now, but yeah. Okay. Anyway, yeah. God, those were the days. I mean, I would see Return of the Living Dead on a Friday night, and there were like 10 people in there.
Yep.
I mean, it was fucking grindhouse, man. It was awesome. And I would tell people, oh, you need to go to the Alamo Draft House. And they're like, what are you talking about? I'm like, they don't let people talk there. You can order beer. You can order beer, you know. And now here we are, 15, 16 years later, and everyone thinks, oh, the Alamo Draft House is the promised land. And we still have many friends, Brian Salisbury, who think that it's much like the Vatican. And they genuflect at the altar. But I got to tell you, it has become more and more corporate, and I've seen it lose its soul. It is still the best place to see a movie, but it is not nearly as good as it used to be. But it also depends on which draft house location you go to.
Okay.
Allison and I went to one in South Austin that is apparently, I didn't know this, but is apparently notorious for being permissive to talkers.
Really?
Even though before every movie, mm-hmm. they have the thing, you know, don't talk, turn your cell phone off, or we'll kick your ass out, and blah, blah, blah. I think that's a lot of marketing gimmick. They've gotten a lot of publicity from that.
I think it used to be true. I think it used to be more true.
I think it
true.
Used to be true, yeah. But at this one, everyone was jabbering.
Yeah.
It's like, there was this one woman and her kid at the end of our row, and the kid kept making noise, and Allison went, shh.
Mm-hmm.
And the kid was talking again, and she went, shh, on the second shush.
Yeah.
The woman, the mom, turns to Allison and says, take the stick out of your ass. Like, yelled it in the middle of the movie.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And I was just like, oh, shit, lady. You don't know what you just did. Oh, God. And
my wife's going to jail.
Oh, yeah.
For
yeah.
infant homicide.
Yeah. Well, before the woman's even finished speaking, Allison isn't even looking at her and just has her middle finger up in the air at this lady. Like,
yep.
Fuck you.
Mm-hmm.
And she tells me later, and I knew this was happening, so I was watching her so closely, that Allison was like, I thought I could just throw this glass of orange juice at her.
Yeah.
I could douse that kid in orange juice. I'm like, no, that's no. So I wrote a little note to the server. The server comes along.
Right.
They said something to the woman. The woman left before the movie was over. They were quiet until then. But half of the theater was talking.
Mm.
I would have gotten carpal tunnel syndrome spending the rest of the movie writing notes like, this asshole won't talk, this asshole won't shut up, this asshole won't shut up.
Well, it should be the sort of thing, like, okay, so if the Alamo has that policy, it should be the sort of thing where there's maybe somebody to police that policy.
Yes.
You shouldn't have to report everybody.
Yes.
They should go in and be like, just walk over to people and be like, you need to stop talking, and if I catch you doing it again, we're going to kick you out, right?
Yeah.
It shouldn't be up to you to be the vigilante fucking justice, because they don't come, you know, for anybody who's never been to the Alamo Draft House, I mean, I think that everybody knows about it, but for those people who've never heard about this before, so theater chain here in Austin, every other row of seats has been removed from the movie theater and replaced with a table. And that table, you can order food. You can order, like, hamburgers and pizzas and all kinds of stuff like that. So there's waiters that come in, and they'll take your order. You write it down on a little piece of paper, and you put that paper up. They'll come in and take your order and then bring you stuff. Like you said, they also have a no-talking policy. They also, for people who don't know, they do a lot of, like, they don't just show movies. They do, you know, oh, we're going to show this old movie. We found a print of this old movie that we're going to show. Or we're going to do a sing-along. We're going to do an 80s sing-along.
We're going to show the Lord of the Rings trilogy, and every time they eat, the audience eats.
Right.
And it costs like $60, but you get like, you know, three meals or whatever.
Or I went to Monty Python, the Holy Grail quote-along, which was weird because I realized that most of the people in the audience couldn't actually just recite Monty Python, the Holy Grail. They were reading the subtitles because they were wrong. But they gave everybody that went in two coconut halves. So whenever they're doing the coconut, everybody got to buy. So they've got fun stuff like that.
They don't do as much of that as they used to.
Yeah. Well, now, to quote the woman there, Alamo kind of has a stick up its ass now.
Yeah.
They've gone from like, hey, we're just an indie. We're going to just take movies and do whatever we want to, man. And now it's like, if you arrive late, you cannot get into the movie theater to see your movie.
Yeah.
You must pick the seat that you want.
They don't reinforce that. They don't enforce that. Somebody walked in like well after the movie had started.
I think that they realized very shortly how stupid that was. I mean, I tell you, the first time I went to Alamo after they had that policy, I walked up to a waitress and I had to go to the bathroom. And I was like, hey, if I leave to go to the bathroom, are you going to let me back in this theater? Because that was ostensibly the problem, was they were like, we don't want people to be bothered by people coming and going across you. And I'm like, well, what if you got to pee? You guys serve buckets of beer, right? And she was like, no, it's fine. And then you have to buy your seat, which I'm kind of a fan of assigned seating, except for, like, if you're going on day one, right? If you're going on opening night to a movie, I'd like to buy my own seat so I can get one on the edge so that I don't have to deal with any of the bullshit,
right?
But if you're going to, like, a show later on, it's kind of a crapshoot unless you can tell, am I going to be sitting right in between two other people or blah, blah, blah. But they've gotten really – there's a whole movie culture in Austin that I just don't get that's like, this is the church of cinema. This is where the greatest moments of your life have happened. Yeah. Everybody genuflect. At the end of the day, did you guys stay there all the way to the end of the movie? Did
oh, yeah.
it even out even a little bit?
Like, no. It was infuriating through the whole thing.
Was Allison able to enjoy herself at all?
Oh, she still loved the movie.
Okay.
She still absolutely loved it. But after that, we were both like, okay, fuck it. I'm not going to the movies anymore.
Okay.
I'm not going to the movies anymore.
I tell you, I don't like going to the movie theater, but I went to go see Guardians. I went to see Winter Soldier and Transformers. You know, we talked about this.
Yeah.
And I found my sweet spot, which is like, movie releases on Friday, Tuesday night, last show, 10:45 show on a Tuesday, on a work day.
Yeah.
When people got to go work tomorrow, usually I can get into a theater. And I usually just go to this regular old movie theater, and there's usually about six other people in there, which in an IMAX-sized theater, you can spread out to the point where it's like, you're mm-hmm. not going to bother me. But to answer the gentleman's question, the reason I don't like going to the movies is, one, I think it's overpriced. Two, if you go to a theater and something like that happens, you've spent, I mean, how much did you guys spend on tickets to go to Guardians?
It was 20, almost, yeah, it was like $20.
$20.
Yeah,
and
it was
then
a
like,
matinee. Yeah.
And then food you had.
Oh, yeah.
Probably another.
I was the only one that ate, and that was like $20-something in food.
Right. So you spent $40
yeah.
and had a shitty time.
Yeah.
Right? Like, I don't want to go to a theater
yeah.
and spend $40 when I could watch. I would rather spend $40, $35 and a $5 bag of microwave popcorn, which I don't know where things are like 10 cents, but and sit on my couch at my house, pause the movie when I want to go to the bathroom.
Absolutely.
Hang out and do that.
Yeah.
Because at the end of the day, I fucking hate people.
Yeah.
I hate them, man.
See, that's the thing is, look, man, I got a big TV. I can wait.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not going anymore. I'm not going to do it. And I actually had friends of mine who work at that location saying, hey, I talked to the area director
yeah.
about this,
mm-hmm.
and because I posted it on Twitter about our horrible experience, and so did Allison. And he's like, I talked to the area director. That's been a problem there. And I'm like, I appreciate it, but you know what? It's don't worry about it. Whatever. I'll just wait. Comes out on VOD or whatever. I'll rent it. I'll buy it. And yeah, I'll just have a grand old time in front of my giant fucking TV in my living room,
yep.
and not have to deal with any of the soul sucking. Sodomite, knuckle dragging shit stains.
But yeah, take any place where there's a lot of people and I hate it. That's
yeah.
I don't like waiting in line.
Bars.
Right? Well, yeah, even some bars.
Even
I
some
like,
bars.
I like going to divey bars.
I like being able to walk up to a bar
mm-hmm.
saying, I would like a beer.
Right.
Not walking up to a bar, standing there for 20 minutes, and then trying to get the fucking bartender's attention.
Yep. Amusement parks.
Yep.
Concerts.
I love rides. Love live music.
Yep.
Can't do it. Can't stand in line. Nope.
And a lot of it just comes to the fact that the older that I get, the harder it is for me to crush my irritation down and keep it as the little black cancer ball inside of me.
Yeah.
Because, like, when you're standing in line, like, you know, we got the Franklin's here in town, the president went there, all that stuff. You're standing in line, right? The person in front of you, just an idiot.
Yeah.
Having the stupidest fucking conversation.
Oh, yeah.
And the older I get, the more I just want to be like, I'm sorry, excuse me. Can you shut up? Can
yeah.
you stop talking because well, you...
Like when we were at E3 and there were those guys there who were like, now what is Assassin's Creed?
Right.
I was like, why are you even here? How did you get in?
I was telling you the story when I was waiting in line for my PS4 at Walmart,
yeah.
right? And there was these college kids behind me. And they were having the dumbest conversation about all this bullshit. And the thing is that there's only a certain amount of that I can tune out. Or when you go to the movie theater, right? I don't necessarily... Okay, let's be honest here. I don't like being in close physical proximity to other human beings. I think they smell bad, and I think that they breathe, and I think
yeah.
that they want to too cavalier about touching
yeah.
you because I was raised differently than that.
Yeah.
But you go to a movie theater, some guy sits in the seat in front of you, some guy who's 6'4", and he doesn't try to hunch down or anything. He's just like, yeah, fuck it, I'm at the movies.
Yep.
I got my hat on.
I'm the only person here in the goddamn universe.
Right, or somebody's behind you, and they're just going to kick your seat the entire time.
Yeah.
And what are you supposed to do? Are you supposed to get up and be like, fuck you, stop kicking my seat, and then they knife you, and then you're dead. And
I have the solution, though.
Stay at home?
Well, or there's or Metal Ray Gear, consider this. There's a movie called Phenomena.
Uh-huh.
It's directed by Dario Argento.
Okay.
It's from the early 80s, I believe.
There's
Jennifer Connelly in it. She can talk to bugs.
Now, wasn't there a movie that had John Travolta in that where he had like a brain tumor, and then he got
That's
special...
Phenomenon.
Wait.
That's Phenomena. No, that's Phenomenon.
Okay.
That's Phenomenon.
Sorry.
Yeah, Phenomena. No. Phenomenon is the one with John Travolta. Phenomena is the Dario Argento one. Anyway, young Jennifer Connelly, she can talk to bugs.
Okay.
It's a weird fucking horror movie. At one point in this movie, there's a chimpanzee with a straight razor.
Okay. Monkey Shines style.
This is a chimpanzee, though.
Oh, shit. Okay.
He's big.
Okay.
He could fuck you up without the straight razor.
Okay.
I think movie theaters need...
Guardian chimps.
Guardian chimps. Where it's like, if you're talking, the monkey just looks at you, the ape looks at you, kind of waves the straight razor at you. Like,
right.
Hey, motherfucker.
You know.
But then, if you talk the second time, he jumps up. Maybe he cuts you. Maybe he chews your fucking face off.
Yeah. Maybe he just like carves a dick into your forehead. And
yeah.
You have to go home with that for the rest
of your
life.
Your brand, it's like a scarlet letter, man. Everybody knows, oh, look at that guy. Why does he have that dick on his forehead? Oh, he talks in the movie
But
theater.
You know what?
Oh.
I've told this story before, and I actually had the reverse happen to me, where I went with my friends to go see The Expendables, and we were laughing at it, and the guy in front of me threatened to throw up a card to get us kicked out because he said, if you giggle one more fucking time, I'm going to put up a card and get you kicked out of here. And it was like, this is a stupid movie. And here I've got some douchebag using the same powers for evil instead of good. So I'm just like, ah, fuck it. I just go to the movies when there's nobody there.
Yeah. Or don't go.
Or don't go. I mean, that's the other thing is that we live in an age where you've got so many fucking entertainment options.
Yeah.
I want to see Guardians, right? I want to see it again. I saw it once in the theater. That's enough to tide me over until that shit comes out on Blu-ray.
Yeah.
And then I'll just go buy it.
Yep.
All right. Thank you, Metal Ray Gear. That was good. That was cleansing. All right. Our next one comes in from Petkov. Petkov says, hey, what's going on, guys? This is Petkov. I hope I'm saying that right. So I'm a big fan of the Souls series, but I feel let down by Dark Souls 2. You should check out this video to get an idea of what I'm talking about. And he has a video there. We're just going to play the entire video, and I'll hold the microphone up. The way the game was presented was completely different from the final product. It's kind of like Aliens Colonial Marines. I'm not saying it's a bad game, but it's not what we were promised. Dark Souls 2 is not on the same level as the previous two games. To better explain, I feel like Demon Souls is Alien, Dark Souls is Predator, and Dark Souls 2 is AVP. Fun, but not as good. I'm sorry, there is nothing fun about AVP. That movie was dog shit on the street.
I never watched them. I never watched either one of them.
I remember that you were skeptical about Dark Souls 2 when it was announced, Jeff, so what do you think? How do you feel about companies presenting a game in one way and then selling it another? I know how much you hated Aliens Colonial Marines. Jason, what do you think? Thanks for answering my question. Rage on and praise the dong. So now I'm going to put this video up while we're looking. So this is what we're seeing here. This is all the pre-release stuff, and you can see how it differs as the video goes on, like especially the lighting model of the game.
Mm-hmm.
So this is kind of goes back to that other conversation that we were having, and to me, it's this one very specific question that says, when a developer shows a version of a game that isn't finished yet, how obliged are they to make sure that that's representative of what the game is going to be, right? Like, if you show, it goes back to the Aliens Colonial Marines thing, right? Is if a developer is not done with optimizing code, right? And they've got these beastly machines that can run a thing at level, you know, at a huge detail level. How obligated are they to make sure that that detail level is then in the final product? Because in Dark Souls 2. There was a lot of stuff. I mean, I saw this version of the game at E3. And I'll tell you right now, what we got when the game came out is very different than this.
Yeah.
Lighting model's totally different. There's areas that aren't there. Like, I pointed out to John, there was an area that they had at E3 that was right before the fight with the Mirror Knight here, right? It was this room that had a bunch of candles in it, and it was a huge room that went up forever, and it had a ton of candles in it. And the idea was that every time somebody died on that boss, it would light a candle. And so you would go into this room at different times, and then every time you went into this room, it might be more and more lit up.
Sure.
And you would reset it at times. Well, that room is now not in the game. It's just a room with some candles. It's been dumbed down, etc. So let's skip past this guy's thing here. So the question is how... So you can see the difference here in these same rooms. Before, when they were originally talking about Dark Souls 2, they made a really big deal about the lighting model and how the lighting model was going to be used, because you would have to light a torch, right? So you couldn't have a shield in your left hand. You had to use a torch in order to see anything in a location. Well, that all got taken out, and there's a question as to whether that was the processing power on the PS3 and the Xbox 360 or whether it was a reaction to people's... complaints about how dark the game was when they saw it at press events. But yeah, I think that it really comes down to how obligated developers are to make sure that what they're showing in an alpha state is going to be representative of what the game is
like. I think every time you see a game before it's released, you if necessary, you should have a disclaimer that says this is not indicative of the final gameplay.
Right.
But if you think about it, movies do that too. Mm-hmm. You'll watch trailers, and there are scenes in trailers that never show up in the movie.
Yeah, I remember
that happens all the time.
Iron Man 2 with the kiss and the helmet throwing it out of the thing. Right, that wasn't even in the movie. Like, yeah, I kept waiting for it to happen. It was like, yeah.
Lots of stuff like that. That happens all the time. But I feel like if you're advertising something, you have an ethical obligation to show it as it will be, or at least say a little disclaimer like, hey, this is just an alpha. Things are probably going to change. And, you know, honestly, like I think most people understand that.
I don't know. I feel like at this point, I mean, this goes back to the previous thing that we were saying, right? Is that at this point, people have to get so far out in front of the advertising for anything to get people to keep it in people, get it in people's minds and keep it in people's minds, right? Yeah. That they're almost like you could say that, well, you shouldn't have shown this version of the game before you had locked down what it was going to be. You go, well, there's a very real possibility that you might have hurt the sales figures of this game by holding back the hype train because people wouldn't have had it as much in their brain.
Yeah.
Like, what is worse, having a game that isn't as having a game that isn't the same as what you were showing before, a la Aliens, Colonial Marines, or in some cases Dark Souls 2, or holding back the promotion train so far that people just don't even really have any conception about what the game is going to be before it comes out.
Right.
It just comes out under the radar. And I think it's a difficult thing. Now, personally, I like to razz Nick about this all the time. I've had my heart broken by video games enough times that I don't look at this stuff anymore as a pure... That's why when people got bent out of shape about Aliens,
yeah,
I wasn't, because it was like, I've already seen this happen. I've had games that tried to hype, and then when I got them, it was just like, oh, fuck, man, you know?
Well, I mean, it depends on how much of a difference it is, too. If it's like, this looks awesome versus the game I get in my hands, it's actually shit,
right?
I.e. Aliens, Colonial Marines.
Right.
I think that's pretty drastic.
I mean, but you can see right here the difference between the two.
In watching this Dark Souls 2 video.
Yeah, in the Dark Souls 2 video. You could see how the early versions of the game were so
dark.
Dark, yeah.
Like, I mean, literally dark. Not like metaphorically, but literally just shadows and darkness.
Yeah, and that it makes the world look a lot more foreboding, right?
Yeah, is it
everything.
Really does. And when you look at the game that came out, it looks like kind of a traditional fantasy game.
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of cases where Dark Souls 2 is. I mean, I've never thought Dark Souls 2 was as good as Dark Souls 1. I still don't think it's a bad game, but when you look at this video that he put up there, it's pretty damning. Like especially if you know anything about Dark Souls 2. There's some of the things about where enemies are placed or where certain things are that really do make you wonder kind of how much of... Because I saw this at E3 the year before it came out, right?
Yeah.
How quickly they turn this stuff around to the point where in this particular area that we were looking at, the first area in the game, there's even routes to enemies and bosses and stuff that aren't there in the full version.
Oh, wow.
So, I don't know. It's interesting. I think that having a... Okay, so we come down to the end of this entire argument, right, Jason? I think having a healthy skepticism for everything in this world will do nothing but benefit you in the long term. Not being a cynic, but when they show a trailer to you for Watch Dogs and it looks like the coolest thing of all time, maybe you just go, I don't know, maybe it'll be cool, maybe not.
As our friend Martin has put it many times... Trailers lie.
Right. But I think it's more than that. I think that you can go, you can be, I'm going to use this as Jeff Life Lessons, two beer Jeff Life Lessons, right? Anytime anybody tells you a thing is the best thing they've ever seen, you should take it with a grain of salt.
Mm-hmm.
Anytime anybody tells you it's the best barbecue they've ever had in their entire life, you should try to tamp down your expectations, because chances are, more times than not, you're going to fall into that trap that we were talking about before of when you are hyped up and then disappointed Whereas if you maintain an even keel, then you can be excited by even a moderately good thing. It doesn't have to
lower
be the best.
Your expectations, lower your standards, everyone.
Exactly. By the way, though, this video is called, I can put this out here for people.
Why don't you put it up on the,
I'll forget by the time we get Terry to put up. It's by Fungo. It's called How We Were Lied to About Dark Souls 2.
It's pretty interesting.
It's interesting. It really is. And the thing is that I got to play that version. I don't know what it was running on at E3, and it seemed to run fine. So I don't really know. Bloodborne's coming out in February. I don't care. They confirmed that shit. February, Bloodborne. What's up? All right. The next one comes in from Henry. Henry says, hey, guys, just got finished with my first Borderlands 2 playthrough and was shopping around for some DLC when I realized you could totally buy the GameStop pre-order bonus on Steam. I said, surely this cannot be. But after a little Googling, I tell you that it is, in fact, the same pre-order bonus. That said, is there any benefit at all to pre-ordering if the bonuses are just going to be released to the public later? If so, what is it? Because I'd sure like to freaking know. Long live Jason the Drinker of Jameson, your loyal patron from Alabama, Henry. P.S., is it really news to people that bitches be tripping for Jason Murphy? It sure ain't to me.
Oh, he must be talking about my... my encounter.
Yeah. Yeah. Last week's.
With those potential ladies of the evening.
Yep. So this is the retro question of the week that we've answered a million times before.
Yeah. It's, hey, if you want it right then, go for it. But you should just know that.
Not necessary. There's enough midnight of launch events. It doesn't really matter.
All of that is going to be available. I can't think of. And I'll say this right now, even though somebody's going to come at me with at least one example, probably.
Yep.
I can't think of any DLC that wasn't made, that was a pre-order bonus that wasn't made available to everyone later.
There's probably one or two, but for the most part, they're so inconsequential that it doesn't really matter.
It's usually cosmetic stuff.
I mean, Dark Souls 2 had a bunch of weapons that you got for pre-order bonus, and now there's just a dude in the game that sells them.
Mm-hmm.
Like when they patched it, you can get them from one guy in the game. So the answer, Henry, is no. There is no benefit to pre-order. Okay, there is the most compelling argument that I've had for pre-ordering is if you don't have a lot of money and you want to pay the game off a little bit at a time.
Sure.
And you want to take that money out of your bank account so you can't spend it on
something else.
Taco Bell orgies, right?
Mm-hmm.
That's a good reason. I've never seen a pre-order bonus that really made a damn bit of difference. I've most of the time. And I feel like video games are one of the only industries where people can have the balls to ask you to pre-buy a thing, and it's generally not necessary. I mean, sometimes, but I've never had a problem finding a game.
Yeah.
You know, when we play, especially now with digital delivery systems.
Exactly.
No reason.
Yeah, I went into a couple of GameStops when I was out in L.A. Pick up Fire Emblem. Mm. And then I was like, oh, you know what, I'll just buy it and download it. Whatever.
Do you have a 3DS?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. I thought we only had one.
Mm-mm.
Okay.
I might have yours. Fuck, I don't know.
No, I've got it. Got it here. I haven't touched it in a while. I need to play the new Phoenix Wright game. But yes, Henry, no reason. No reason whatsoever to pre-order anything ever. History of Mankind. Don't bother. The worst thing that will happen to you, the worst thing in the world that will happen to you is...
herpes.
Everything... Yes, space herpes. Everything in your... Every place in your area that sells a video game will be out of that, so you'll have to order it on Amazon and wait for a day.
Yeah,
that is
exactly.
Or buy it on a digital copy and wait for it to download for like 6 hours. Those are the worst things that can happen to you. So... All right, next one comes in from... Sir Brinkle Esquire, Brinklehoff Esquire. All right. Greetings, Jason and Jeff. This is Sir Brinklehoff Esquire on the website, and I have a question for you guys. Sometimes when I accomplish something in a video game, my brother will make a comment along the lines of, that doesn't matter because it's not real. Now, I know his comments are not serious and he's just teasing me, but I can't help think about people who legitimately have this opinion towards people who play video games. I can understand people not wanting to play video games because of preference, but acting like you're better than them simply because you've so greatly defined some, I don't know what that word
epistemic
is. Epistemic barrier between physical achievements and digital ones. What is your opinion on these people? And hail Dongocles. Fuck them.
Yeah, fuck them. Exactly. Who cares? Did it make you feel good? Did it hurt anybody? No. Do it.
Yeah, I was listening to I pulled out this question because it goes to another thing that I was kind of digging into that I first started thinking about because of the Cracked podcast yet again, which is talking about the way that people will try to make things happen in their lives, right? So you'd be like, I want to lose weight, right? So I'm going to work out. You go, okay, when are you going to work out? Well, I'm going to start going to bed 2 hours early every night. I'm going to wake up in the morning. I'm going to go work out, et cetera, et cetera. So this is the way that a lot of people think about this sort of thing. But what nobody ever really thinks about is that there's a reason why you were staying up those extra 2 hours dicking around on YouTube. That has merit, the same way that video games have merit.
Yeah.
Is that there are certain things that society sees as less, especially in entertainment, but when you look at the psychology of human beings, people have to get away from shit for a little while.
Yeah.
And video games are a perfect way to do that.
You have to decompress, and you can't just do that while you're sleeping.
Right. Like, if every achievement that every person ever had to be a thing in real life, whether it was learning a skill or being the best at something or whatever, 99% of humanity would be let down all the time.
Yeah. Well, Sir Brinkelhoff Esquire, he could say the same thing, like, I read 37 books this summer. You know, it's like, really? Well, that doesn't matter because it's not real.
Right.
Fuck you.
Right. So yeah, don't ever let anybody try to take that stuff away from you.
Don't let anybody try to take anything away from you. Never, ever. If somebody tries to take something away from you, whether it's a little feeling of joy,
right,
or maybe the last sheet of pie,
right,
stab them in the fucking throat.
Not your dirty dishes when you're at the restaurant, or your coat when you're at the friend's house.
Yeah, don't let them.
Don't let them. Just hold on to it. Like, no! Yeah. It is mine!
Fight for what is yours.
It's hell, man. Every time Jason finishes a beer, he just carries it around my house. I can't get away from him.
Yep, I'm like a dog. It's like my dogs. They'll carry shit around that they don't want, but they don't want the other dogs to have it.
Right.
That's what you gotta be like.
Yeah. But, yeah, don't – I mean, anybody who's trying to essentially – I mean, I think that we've – it's one of the core tenets of Rage Select that we've tried to grind home every week, right, is anybody who's judging the merit of what you're doing is probably a fucking douchebag. Don't listen to them and maybe set their car on fire. So fuck them.
Yeah, fuck them.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's the thing is that – do you enjoy it? Well, don't let anybody talk shit to you about it. As long as you're not, like, you know, diddling kids or fucking animals or whatever.
Right.
Yeah, who cares? You playing Dungeons and Dragons? Roll those dice. Roll 20s. Fuck them.
Yep.
You know, you playing video games? Beat the boss. Get all the achievements. Do it. And don't let anybody tell you that this defines your value as a person. No, they're just jealous. They're trying to tear it down because they don't understand it.
Yep.
And because they don't get it. And you do. And so you're in a better place than them. So fuck them. And I say that even as I sit here talking shit about sports games all the time. But whatever.
We've actually had a pretty good time with the last few sports games we've played.
We have.
All right. This one's for you, Jason. This one comes in from Cortovos. Hail, acolytes of the mighty dog. May it always be hard and throbbing. Do you think that we're alienating female viewers by talking about the Dong Lord all the time? Or
what?
Do you think they're in it for the Dong Lord as well? You know, acolytes of the Dong Lord?
Sometimes. Not all chicks, but a lot of chicks do like hard dick.
Right. Should we come up with like the Vag Priestess that is like sire to the Dong Lord?
Perhaps
at some point?
Perhaps we should.
Maybe we'll work on that.
Perhaps we should.
All right. First of all, I loved the three episodes you did about Destiny, though I was disappointed that because they kept referring to the darkness, the final boss fight wasn't against Jackie Estacado, which would have been hilarious.
Or the band.
I believe in a thing called love. I think Grant and I made that joke.
Did you?
I think we did. I think there was at least one of those. Now, my question is for the resident comic book master, though of course Jeff can also put in his two cents. Which secondary or tertiary character would you like to see get more attention? My pick would be DC's Death, the sister of Morpheus. All the stories I have read about her are both fun to read and thought-provoking. She is one of the main reasons I read entirely through Sandman. Thanks for answering this question, and keep raging on. Kind regards, Cortovos. Do you think that if they had made like a whole series of... I think that one of the reasons Death is such a good character is because there were so few stories that they were all really good, that they had to keep coming up with a weekly or monthly book for her.
Yeah, that's a good question. As far as like... As far as like secondary or tertiary characters, I'd like to see more Jonah Hex because I like, as I've said before, I want to see, and I know All Star Westerns just got canceled.
Is he a tertiary character?
I think
he's a main character, right?
I don't think he's primary.
Had his own movie.
Yeah, but that bombed, and most people still don't know who Jonah Hex is.
Oh, okay.
You know, when I think primary, I think, you know, Batman, Flash, right. You know, Justice Leaguers. But I'd like to see more of Jonah Hex kind of in the whole weird Western stuff like Lansdale did. There was on one of the direct-to-video DC movies, there was a 70s bit about the Spectre, which was really good. It was set in the 70s, and it was kind of crime noir in L.A. or something like that. That was really cool.
Did you think, I mean, I know that people use this argument on Superman all the time, but Spectre just seems like ridiculously overpowered.
Oh,
right?
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
It's hard to challenge the Spectre because he's a fucking god. Like, it's hard to get all up in the Spectre's face and be like, I'm going to punch you.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. Another one on the Marvel side, I'd like to see more Longshot.
Yeah.
I always liked Longshot quite a bit. He had a little miniseries that was not very good recently. But, yeah, I always always liked that guy. He's,
you know, be a cool
goofy
series?
And naive.
Would be if you had Longshot, Domino, Road Trip, since they both have the luck powers.
With all of their luck.
Yeah, just like the luckiest people in the world. Maybe even have a thing where, like, you could get into some kind of how their luck ends up canceling each other out when they're too close together. Oh, but then handcuff them together, like in that one movie.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, and then they could go across the country and get their luck powers canceled out and have to do shit. I was thinking, is this Harvey Bullock?
Harvey Bullock. Well, he's gonna be front and center in the Gotham TV series.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think I'd love to see Harvey Bullock as like actually, okay. So I know that the temptation is to make him like, well, it turns out that he's actually super smart and he's just been playing dumb.
Right.
But I actually just more like to see him kind of in the same vein, I guess, be more like kind of a dumb luck kind of guy.
Yeah.
He's not really super smart, but he's moral and he believes in what he's doing. He just happens to kind of be in the right place at the right time. Maybe you could even tie that in like in the series finale into like, it's not that he's actually in the right place at the right time.
Yeah.
It's that Batman is this is early Batman before he comes on the scene. He's actually arranging shit to the point where, you know.
Well, you should watch some of this stuff for Gotham. It comes on next week.
Okay.
And Harvey Bullock is played by Donald Logue.
Who is...
Did you ever see Terriers?
Yes.
He's the main guy in Terriers.
The bigger guy.
Yeah.
He's
playing Harvey Bullock.
Oh, okay. I can see that.
Perfect.
Well, why the fuck is there not a Terrier season 2?
Oh,
why is there only one
season? Terriers is so fucking good.
Go watch Terriers, you guys. The other thing I was thinking about was, but they already have done that, right? They've already, X-Factor turned into Madrox as the main character, right?
Yep, yep.
Okay. Because I've always
and
thought
now
that
that's disbanded and Madrox is like living on a farm or some shit.
I've always thought that Madrox the Multiple Man was a really interesting character.
Yeah.
Like, with a really interesting power, you know? I don't know. I just like the second stringer people. Are you still reading Moon Knight?
Yeah.
Is it good?
I think it's very good. I think they just did Warren Ellis's last issue.
Okay.
And every one of them was top-notch.
It's good to know Ellis still has chops because I like Warren Ellis quite a bit.
Yeah, it was really, really good.
And he's still mean, but he has more of a heart than Ennis does. Like, you know.
Ennis is just like a, I don't know, he's like a 13-year-old who picks the wings off of butterflies and shit.
I'll tell you who I want to see in the answer to this question. All right, so. One of my favorites, I think it's pretty common knowledge from when we talk about comics on the website, Transmetropolitan is my favorite comic series of all time.
Yep.
What may be my favorite issue of all of Transmetropolitan is the one where Mitchell Royce puts Spider's life back together behind the scenes.
Oh, yeah.
And he comes in, he gives this beautiful speech about how, like, you're just a writer. You have to write. I'm an editor, and I do everything. Everything else. You say your writing was gone. I say, fuck you. I know how to get shit back. Like, you know. And he gets into a cab at the end and he says, like, first I'm going to need many, many drugs and I'm going to take them all. Then I'm going to need many hookers and I'm going to take them all too, or something like that. I'd love to see a spinoff. I'd like to see like a 4-issue series of just Mitchell Royce from the Transmetropolitan series. You have any other answers?
No, I think that covers it.
Okay. All right, next up, we've got, I'm going to skip that one real fast. Let's see, hold on for a second. No, these are both short. And how much time do we have? All right, this gentleman, Tony, has been sending this email in for a while, so I'm going to go ahead and read it.
Okay.
This is some career advice.
Okay? Oh, okay.
Dear Jeff and Jason, it's Tony again. He actually sent us in another one. Sort of a long one. So I currently work for the Air Force as a civilian working on KC-135s. That's a hot and spicy, right? That's the wing sauce.
Sadness bowl?
Yeah. Okay. All right. I'm also part of the Army Guard here in Oklahoma working on Blackhawks. Working for the Air Force, I make good money and really like working on fixed wings, but I don't really get any weekends off, and management is all about numbers, not quality. A while back, I was approached by one of our full-timers down at the facility I drill at, and the short of it is I was offered a job. Down there, I'd still be working on aircraft, except it'd be rotary. Almost the same pay, but I'd be losing out on over $600 a month for being on a premium shift here at Tinker, and plus no OT. This is starting to get into Destiny levels of things I don't know what they are. All my leave would transfer over along with TSP, retirement, medical, being it's still a federal job, but perks for being down here, being down there are four-day work weeks, puts me in the eyes of the higher-ups, which could help with rank advancement and becoming a crew chief. Would also help me getting into the medevac unit. Just wondering what your thoughts are. I know you guys get quite a few of these life choice questions, but it's nice to hear both of your thoughts and opinions. Stay classy, Tony. P.S. I forgot to mention that this other job, I would get to fly on a regular basis and do all that cool high-speed, low-drag shit. Tony, I don't know why you're sending us this question, because it sounds like you really want to go to this other job, yeah. And the only thing is it's going to be less money.
Yeah.
And in the long term, you're going to get to do all the shit that you want to do. So I'd say go do the shit you want to do, man.
Absolutely, Tony. Money's not everything, man.
You will figure out a place. I mean, $600 a month, you know, that's not a chump change.
Yeah, whenever you come to any decision, your deciding factor really should be what's going to make me happier in the long run.
Yeah.
And, you know, a lot of times it's not money. Maybe it is, but a lot of times it's not. So go with the one, and don't, you know, you do have to consider short-term satisfaction. Mm-hmm. And make sure that that's not clouding your judgment. But, yeah, what's going to make you happiest in the long run? Is it going to be having enough money, you know, that extra $600 a month or whatever, so you can, I don't know, go out to Applebee's one more time or something? No.
You have a really inflated price idea of Applebee's. Hey, you want to go to Applebee's tonight? No, man, I've only got $550, so we have to wait until next week. I've been saving all month.
But no, go with what's going to make you happy, and that is that's what's going to going to lead you down the right path.
Well, plus I leave out parentheses on longer emails like this, but there is a parenthesis where you say that you make $60K plus a year. Yeah. So $600 a month is, you know, it's not chump change, but you're making solid money.
But we don't know, you know, if he's got a family to raise,
sure,
where he is,
sure, because
that could make all the difference in the world.
Yeah.
But yeah, go.
I mean, from your email, it sounds like you want to do the other job.
Yeah. Yeah. It sounds like you've already made your decision. Do it.
Get at it. All right. We got two more short ones, Jason. First one, dear Rage Crew, I watched Hellraiser for the 1 billionth time the other day, and I still find myself completely amazed at the resurrection of Brother Frank. I find myself in love with practical effects and only good friends with CGI. What scenes of practical effects make you eye-gasm? And a quickie Jeff question, which Souls game is more approachable for a noob, Demon Souls or Dark Souls? All the best, you gentlemen of Rage and Dick Jokes Patio. Jason, would you like to start? I'm going to talk for a second about Souls. So if you want to start with other examples of practical effects in movies.
The Thing is number one. That's the one. The Thing, and also From Beyond, has a lot of good stuff in there. That's a very weird movie. But it's got some cool practical effects in it. It is incredibly fucked up. It was, I want to say it was Stuart Gordon, if I'm not mistaken. And it's an adaptation of an H.P. Lovecraft short story. It's got Jeffrey Combs in it and Ken Foree.
Was it Jeffrey Combs or was it the
other Jeffrey
guy?
Combs.
Oh, okay.
No, it was definitely Jeffrey Combs.
Who was the Grima Wormtum guy? I thought that was.
Oh, that was Brad Dourif.
Brad Dourif.
Yeah,
okay.
He wasn't in it.
Okay. And that lady gets all weird and bondage-y.
Yeah, yeah, there's some nudity in it and some violence. It's weird shit. It's good. But The Thing is the watermark for practical monster effects in a horror film. That's the go-to.
Yeah. Both Alien and Aliens do a really good job. But especially in Alien, where they've got the guy creeping around in the background as the alien or whatever. I will never forget how trauma we did. I don't know if it was you and I. No, it was Grant and I talked about things that traumatized you that you saw when you were a kid. I briefly caught the moment in the stuff where that dude's face cut.
Yeah.
And as a kid, I was just like, yeah.
But yeah, the thing is that really just the gold seal of all of those, and it still holds up. And it's one of those where it has practical effects and it still shows you everything.
Mm-hmm.
You know, not a lot of cutaways, not a lot of stuff done in shadows. It's all like, here it is.
Yeah.
Drink it in.
Yep. As far as Demon Souls or Dark Souls, it kind of depends. Demon Souls is a little bit more nebulous about the mechanics of the game. It doesn't tell you as much as Dark Souls does. Like, Demon Souls will let you fuck yourself, and you won't even know that you're fucking yourself until it's too late. But you can brute force your way through Demon Souls, because in Demon Souls you can collect health items. You can just buy enough health items to brute force your way through a level. Dark Souls limits your health items to the point where you have to get good at going through a level in order to get to the end. So you have a limited number of health items. You can only get from this one point to the next point, so you have to learn how to do it. So it kind of depends. If you think that you're a person who's easily frustrated, I would say that Demon Souls probably is a better place to start because you can brute force it. But if you're willing to jump in with both feet, die a lot, and learn a lot, I think the Dark Souls is a more refined game and better. All right, last question comes in from Jujitsu, who says, hello, Ragecasters. If NASA were to create a Voyager 3 with an updated version of the Golden Record and tasked you to provide 3 video games and 3 movies to send to space for extraterrestrials to see, what would you choose? They should be good representations of our progress with both mediums. P.S. I think after a year of Jeff versus beer, it's going to be Jeff versus cirrhosis. Jujitsu, I don't drink for like most of the week. It's only 1 day, 2, 3 days. Like.
All right. 3 video games. 3 movies.
Universal Soldier 1, 2, and 3 for the movies.
Okay, good.
Let's see. A Boy and His Blob, Blaster Master 2 on the Genesis, and
bold
Ghostbusters
choice.
On the Atari 2600 for the video games.
Bold choice.
Yep.
I'm going to go with Super Mario Brothers for one of the video games, Tetris for one of the other ones, and then to show how far we've come along, Black Flag. You know, something gorgeous and big and sprawling. For movies, Star Wars.
Right.
Of course. And then, Guardians of the Galaxy.
Transformers 4.
No, Transformers 4.
And
no.
Bad Boys 2.
Nope. No.
No?
Okay. Nope. Star Wars, Guardians of the Galaxy, and then The Big Lebowski.
The Big Lebowski?
Yes.
I mean, it depends. I whenever anybody asks a hypothetical like this, I go like, well, if it's like for the good of mankind, right? It's like, all right, for movies, you got to put like what? Citizen Kane.
Yeah.
You know.
Well, see, and I was also trying to pick stuff that had launched after Voyager 2, or that was available after Voyager 2.
Oh, okay.
You know.
Okay. So Inception, Bad Boys 2, and Ghostbusters 2.
He's not even no.
I don't know.
Ghostbusters 2 is shit.
And the Ghostbusters 2 is not that bad. You guys all know that Jeff has a stupid fucked up view of movies, right? Like I got to do a whole thing where Grant and I were doing an academy, and I talked a bunch of shit about Requiem for a Dream, and somebody was like, "Okay, so Jeff hates Requiem for a Dream, but loves Transformers," and I was like, I do both of those things, and I understand that when you put them side by side, I seem like a monster man. I don't know. Yeah, probably Star Wars, probably Citizen Kane, maybe probably some kind of artsy fartsy bullshit.
Harold and Kumar Go to White Castle.
Yes, Harold and Kumar Go to White Castle. I don't know. It would be okay. So you got one drama, you've got one action, and then you'd probably need one comedy. Airplane. Super Mario Brothers.
Dark Souls.
No, not Dark Souls. The aliens would get pissed off and then come and destroy us because they can't get past.
Oh,
the
maybe we should put something in there that's an implicit threat.
Yeah?
Yeah, like Contra. It's like, you come and we'll fuck you up.
Check out what we think about aliens that look like dicks, you dick aliens.
We'll just send 2 guys.
That's right.
Fuck you up with their spread guns.
Yeah. I don't know. I'd say just look down a list. You know what? Pong. Super Mario Brothers, and then probably, I don't know, just pick a modern game.
Skyrim.
Skyrim, sure. That works. Yeah. All right, and that's our show for the week. Folks, if you want to send in an email, mail@rageselect.com is the email address. Don't send it to the admin account. Please don't send it to the admin account because I won't read if it's there. And let's see, stay tuned tomorrow for another Dojo episode, and we will catch you next week.